Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of The Devil's Steps, written by Arthur Upfield and read by Peter Hosking. Part of the appeal of Arthur Upfield's stories lies in their authentic portrayal of many aspects of outback Australian life in the 1930s and through into the 1950s. The dialogue, especially, is a faithful evocation of how people spoke. Hence, these books reflect and depict the attitudes and ways of speech of that era, particularly with regard to Aborigines and to women. In reproducing these books, the publisher does not endorse the attitudes or opinions they express. Chapter 1. At Wide View Chalet. The alarm clock beside Bisker's bed called him to his daily life at 5:30. The clock appeared to be armour-clad and completely shock-resisting, for every time the alarm began it was cut short by a calloused hand which crashed down upon it with such force that a lesser mechanism would have been smashed flat. At 5:30 on this first morning in September it was quite dark. Inside Bisker's room it was coal black, and, until Bisker began the recitation of the first complaint of the day, utterly silent. Bisker's voice was loud with emphasis. "A man ought to be sunk a million miles below the bottom of the deepest well on earth," he said, in his heart duty wrestling with the desire to strike. "Oh, what a limbless fool I am. Curse the drink! You dirty swine, it's you that stops me saving enough money to get me out of this frost-bitten, rain-drowned, lousy hole of a joint. Get me back to where there's 1,000 tons of good dry wood to the acre, and where a man can lie abed all day if he wants to. Oh, blast. If that old cow says 2 words to me this morning, I'll up and slap her down." Striking a match, he lit the hurricane lamp standing on the wooden kerosene case beside the bed. Then he took up one of two pipes, in the bowl of which had been compressed the dried dottles taken during the previous day from the other pipe. Bisker was a connoisseur in the art of nicotine poisoning, and he favoured an extra strong dose before rising in the mornings, to be followed with mere ordinary doses during the day. To avoid wasting time, the special dose was loaded into the pipe overnight. For 5 minutes he smoked with only his face outside the blankets, even his face being partially protected from the air by a bristling, stained, grey moustache. "Fancy a man coming down to this," he exclaimed loudly. "And me an up-and-at-em cattle driver most of me life. Just tells you what the booze'll do to a bloke. Oh, well." Slipping out of bed, he revealed naked, bandy legs below the hem of a cotton shirt over a flannel undervest. He stepped into trousers, which appeared to be wide open to accept his legs, and small and rotund paunch, pulled on a pair of old socks, and then stepped into heavy boots he did not trouble to lace. A thick cloth coat and a battered felt hat completed the ensemble, but to this had to be added the working kit comprising one pipe, a plug of jet-black tobacco, a clasp knife, a tin containing wax matches, and a corkscrew. Taking up the lamp, he passed outside. It was not so very cold after all, although his breath did issue in the form of steam mixed with tobacco smoke. By the aid of the light, he followed a narrow cinder path to its junction with a wide area of bitumen fronting a row of garages. Across this area, he lurched along a path, also of bitumen, which skirted a large wood stack and eventually arrived at a small door at the rear of Wide View Chalet. The door he opened with a key which he took from beneath a brick, and on passing into the house, he found himself in a scullery in which part of his day was spent. From the scullery, he entered the kitchen, switched on the electric light, blew out his lamp, and filled the tin kettle with water to place on a small electric stove. He then proceeded with the least noise possible to clean out the 4 grates of the cooking range, set in the centre of the kitchen, and to light fires in them. By the time he had completed this work, the kettle was at the boil. Bisker made a pot of tea, and whilst the tea was drawing, he passed out to the scullery and refired the boiler, which provided hot water to the bathrooms and to every bedroom. He was pouring milk into two cups when the cook appeared in the kitchen.
"Morning,"
she said with a kind of lisp as she was minus her false teeth.
"Day,"
snarled Bisker. "Cup of tea?"
"Too right. I don't work till I get it."
Bisker poured tea into two cups. The cook accepted hers without speaking, set it down on the stove and herself on a chair she drew near to the now roaring fires. Bisker carried his cup in one hand and his pipe in the other to take a position before one of the fires from which he glared down at the cook.
"A man order,"
he began waving his pipe on a level with his moustache.
"Oh, shut up," pleaded the cook. "Give me a light and be a gentleman."
Bisker snorted yet again. He put his cup down on the stove and from a fire withdrew a billet of kindling wood, which he presented to the cook. She snatched it from him and lit the cigarette she had produced from her apron pocket. Mrs. Parks was only slightly under 40. She was large, very large. Her brown hair was drawn tightly against her head with masses of curling pins. Her large face was deathly white, and against the background of her face her little red nose appeared not unlike a tiddlywinks counter. Bisker drank his tea without swallowing.
"Have another?"
he asked.
"Gosh, fill it up. 37 to cook for as well as the missus. 3 maids, a drink steward and you. What a life."
Bisker took the cups over to the wall bench, filled them and brought them back to the now warming stove.
"How'd you sleep?"
he inquired, now a little more cheerful.
"Better than if I'd had you beside me," replied the cook. "And you be sure to shave early or the missus will be roaring you up again. You're a disgrace about the place. Thank heaven the winter won't last much longer. Must have been another frost by the feel of it."
"She froze hard, but it isn't so cold outside as I expected," averred Bisker. "Wind must have shifted to the west just before I got up. Oh, I suppose I'd better get on with the blasted boots."
"Yes, and you go quiet about it too,"
commanded Mrs. Parks, stubbing out a cigarette.
"We don't want the old cat in her tantrums 3 days running."
Bisker stood before the cook, sliding the palms of his hands together and leering.
"One of these days," he said slowly, "you're going to hold her while I cut her throat. Slowly. The old..."
Mrs. Parks feigned indignation. She snatched up her cup, glared at Bisker and said a little shrilly,
"You cut out that murder stuff and get along with your work. You'll be having me in the truth next, and then what'll me husband say when he comes home?"
"Stick your teeth in,"
Bisker replied, and swiftly retreated to the scullery. Retreated backwards, as though he were withdrawing from the presence of royalty. From a box on a shelf he obtained a pencil of chalk and, again entering the kitchen, crossed it and passed through a doorway into a passage which led him to the public lounge. Here he switched on lights, passed through the lounge, and so gained the passage which led to the bedrooms. Switching on more lights, he collected the footwear of the guests, marking on the soles the number of the room outside of which they awaited him. There were 10 pairs of men's boots, 16 pairs of women's shoes, and 3 pairs of children's boots. All these he took back to the scullery and then went on another journey to collect a pair of shoes from outside the door of the room occupied by Miss Eleanor Jade, the proprietress of Wideview Chalet. Standing at a bench, Bisker began to work on the collected footwear. Every pair was of good quality, and every pair bespoke their utility for walking. This morning, Bisker expected to find them dry, for the weather had been fine for the last 4 days. He was therefore easily provoked to profanity when he began work on a pair of men's shoes, size 8, and bearing on the sole the figure 5.
"Must have been out walking late last night, the blinking foreign German," he complained. "More work, as though a man hasn't got enough to do. Must have got him as wet as hell."
These shoes took him 3 times as long to clean as any previous pair. Having done them, he began to whistle and continued whistling till he came to the last pair. These were a woman's shoes, size 6, collected from the bedroom door of Miss Eleanor Jade. Like the shoes from number 5, they were also damp. Chortled Bisker.
"The old bird, the old cat, the old, old..."
Ceasing his chortling, he began to brush the shoes collected from the bedroom door behind which slept Miss Eleanor Jade.
"Now, let me see.
Number 5 goes for a walk late last night. In he comes, has a drink or two. I must ask George about that. Then toddles off to his room, takes off his shoes and plants them outside his door for me to clean. Yes, that's how it was. But that same argument can't be applied to the old cat. She wouldn't be out walking late last night, and yet her shoes are wet same as number 5's. The old... Yes, she could have. A little bit of love, eh? Sherlock Holmes, me.
Having completed this task, Biscuit placed the footwear on a large wooden tray and went back to the bedrooms. By the time he had replaced them where he found them, it was almost full daylight. He left the house to return to his room, a hut built in a far corner of the spacious garden. On the way, a magnificent panoramic view of valley and distant mountains was presented to his unappreciative eyes. From the wide, stone-balustraded veranda extending the full length of the house front, a well-kept lawn tilted gently down to the distant wire fence bordering a main highway. The lawn, as well as the small shrubs in beds spaced upon it, was white with frost, a glittering white, upon which lay the reflected light of the sun now rising above the far mountains, 30-odd miles across the valley. After shaving and washing in ice-cold water, Biscuit returned to the kitchen where the aroma of cooking food and simmering coffee caused him to forget momentarily the agony of the first 5 minutes of his day, following the ringing of the alarm clock. Outside, the air was milder. The bushman in Biscuit was quick to note the remarkable rise in the temperature after the sun had risen. A uniformed maid entered the kitchen with an empty tray on which she had taken early morning tea to Miss Jade's guests. George, the drinks steward and table waiter, was already at breakfast at a side table to which Biscuit drifted. Another maid set down before him his breakfast of bacon and eggs, toast and coffee, for Miss Jade fed her staff well.
"Morning, George."
"Morning, Biscuit," replied George, a sleek man of about 30, pale of face, dark of eyes and hair. "Nice day."
"Yeah, it's going to be a warm day after the frost. Wind's gone round to the west. The frost'll thaw off quick. Might get rain tonight. What time do you get to bed?"
"About 11, replied George. The men were tired and cleared off to bed early.
"You tuck 'em in nice and comfy?"
Biscuit inquired with his mouth full. George smiled in his superior manner. "All bar the bridegroom," he admitted. "I left him to the bride." Biscuit winked and leered. He glanced furtively over his shoulder, observed that one of the maids and the cook were standing close, winked again at George and refrained from making an evil remark. The remark was never made because George, having finished his breakfast, departed for the dining room. Presently, Biscuit rose and shuffled out of the kitchen. He left the building by the scullery door and crossed the yard to the woodstack, where, sitting on a splitting log in the warm sunshine, he fell to slicing chips from his tobacco plug. The slight problem of the wet shoes had vanished from his mind. Having smoked for 10 minutes, he put away his pipe and took up an axe, with which he proceeded to split foot-length logs into billets for the cooking range. In addition to the kitchen and the boiler fires, there were the lounge and dining room fires to be fed. Great blazing fires so much preferred to the cheerless gas and electric fires in the homes of the guests. For half an hour, Biscuit split wood and then took a broom and began the daily sweeping of the bitumened areas and the paths. And then, when he had worked round to the long front of the house, he heard Miss Jade's voice.
"Biscuit, have you seen Mr. Grumman this morning?"
Biscuit turned and looked upward to see his employer standing at the veranda balustrade, her bejewelled hands sparkling in the golden sunlight.
"No, ma'am,"
he replied. He stood staring at the old cat, the wonder in his mind, as it was always when he looked at her, that anyone could be so fortunate. Under 40, Miss Jade's hair was as black as night. Her eyes were dark and big, and even now as she faced the sun her makeup was perfect. Her voice had the faultlessness of tone and accent which must have been acquired only by long practice.
"Very good. Continue your work, Biscuit," she commanded.
Biscuit obeyed, but his thoughts were not gentlemanly. He was sweeping the path running parallel with the house front. It crossed midway the wider path leading from the veranda through the lawn to the wicket gate in the bottom fence above the road. He had almost reached the far end of the path when, to his astonishment, he observed a man in working clothes walking up from the wicket gate. Bisker looked involuntarily for Miss Jade, for no person other than a guest was permitted to enter the grounds of Wideview Chalet by that gate. Miss Jade was no longer on the veranda. Bisker dropped his broom and ambled down the path to meet the social outcast. He knew him.
"Hey, Fred," he called when he was 20 feet away from the intruder. "Don't you know that none of the slaves can use that there gate to come in?"
The intruder was tall, thin and bony. His blue eyes watered. The tip of his nose suspended a water drop. He said, with the unruffled calm of a man who will not be hurried, "Come on down, I've got something to show you."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.